Good evening. This is a reading of the Black Man's Guide to Understanding the Black Woman by Scheherazade Ali. Chapter 10, Raising Children. The children, like every other entity at the black woman's disposal, are often used to attain certain goals with the black man. The first and most important issue here is that the rearing of children is the foremost responsibility of the black woman, not the daycare center, not the grandmothers or the nanny. When the black woman raises her own children, she imagines she is using modern methods that create a well-adjusted, well-mannered, lovely child. But what eventually creeps through, if she's not interrupted, is that she raises her own children the same way she was raised. Since the black woman spends a lot of her mental energies thinking about how to capture the black man and get him to do her bidding, she is often frustrated with the children. This frustration may take the form of yelling, being verbally abusive, beating them, or leaving them with sitters so she doesn't have to deal with them. The black man who loves children does not understand what all the yelling and screaming is all about. He gets along fine with the children, and they obey and cooperate with him. But the black woman who is impatient will take out her hostilities about her condition on the children, who in turn rebel, run amok, and play all sorts of games on her just to irritate her more. While not properly raising or teaching the children, she will sometimes dress them immaculate. She will also try to get the eldest child, be it male or female, to take part or most of the responsibility for caring for the younger children in the household. When this redirection of duty is overused, it robs the older child of their own youth because they are made to think like an adult parent in order to take care of younger brothers and or sisters. If the black man works late or is out a lot, she becomes more angry because she thinks he is out having fun while she's stuck at home with a bunch of scrawling brats. If the woman is angry with the man, she will neglect the children in small ways. If the black man notices this, he will remind her that she should take better care of the children, and she might remind him that he ain't the one taking care of them. She is. She may stop cooking or washing their clothes by claiming that she is exhausted and can't do another thing. Examining this situation, some black women have managed to work this game so effectively on the black man that in many homes today, the man is cooking, cleaning, ironing, grocery shopping alone, and getting the children off to school, bathe at night, and put to bed, because the woman will either not do it or she has convinced him that he should. It is her job to do the mothering part. He should assist. If the man has a son or daughter who looks exactly like him, remarkably like him, and the woman is constantly mad at the man, She will sometimes unconsciously or purposely mistreat the child, since she cannot get back at the father himself. She will take it out on the child. This is a very dangerous practice. The innocent child can be caught up in this web of abuse and be at risk. It is impossible for a black woman to hate the father of her child and treat the child normally. The child is daily and nightly reminder of her intimate relationship with the man. The baby must be a novelty at first, but as time passes and the child develops and grows up, it may be a problem to her because he or she represents the father's presence. Any behavior traits the child displays that are exactly like the father's makes her even angrier. And she will beat and punish the child to try to remove the part that reminds her of the father. If the black man is not present to defend himself, she may tell the child bad things about its father. This mostly happens when she and the child's father are not together in current relationship. She will tell the child, one, your father don't care nothing about you. I'm the one who loves you. Two, he don't take care of you. I do. Three, if he wanted you, he'd be here with you. Four, he ain't thinking about you. He's out with his other woman. Five, I can't buy you that because your father won't get me any money. Six, your father is a bum. He ain't got no job. He ain't got nothing. She says these and any other insult she can think of to turn the child against the father because she is angry with him. She wants the children to take her side against the father to punish him. It is a given that the relationship between the man and his children is directly related to the relationship he has with the mother. The black man loves his children, but does not have the same maternal instincts of the mother because it is not his nature. But when forced, he will care for and raise the child himself. If the father visits the child and the child is standoffish, uptight, starts to cry, or is hostile and combative, the black man can be sure that it is because of something the mother has told it about him. The small child's mind cannot decipher the information the black mother tells it about its father. The child does not know how to make the transfer. They do not know how to front. They are happy or sad. The poor black man does not know that all of this has taken place behind his back and is baffled and may rebuff or spank the child because of his whining or uncooperation. He does not know that the entire act has been staged by the mother in the background. The black woman who is separated or angry with her man is negative about him in front of the child. She doesn't realize how harmful this is because she is only concerned with her own happiness or unhappiness. Secretly, she hopes that the child, although immature, will make a plea for her father, for her in the father's presence. It is the black woman who must teach the black child to love and respect the father, just as she teaches it everything else. It must be taught to love and respect its father whether he is financially taking care of it or not. The black woman removes the father figure from her child's life because of her own dissatisfaction, without having anything to replace it with. A black mother, no matter how much she tries, cannot be a black father to a black child. There are many non-monetary values that the black father is capable of teaching the child. The black man owns the child just as much as the black mother. She does not have more ownership just because she carried the baby in her womb. A woman cannot have a baby without the aid of a man. He is equal owner of the child and has equal right to love it and care for it. The parental coalition gives unity of direction and security to the child. The black woman is also too trusting of strangers with her child. She does not know the personal quirks or value of the people who work in the daycare center. If a child is with an adult for 6 to 9 hours per day, Monday through Friday, and sometimes weekends, some of the ideas and attitudes of the sitter are being passed on to the child. Other than occasional exceptions, the black woman should stay with her own child. This is not saying that a qualified, trusted babysitter should not be employed, but to take an 8-week old baby to a daycare center and leave it there until its school age is a mistake. The extended family on both sides should take up the job of keeping the child, and they too should be given explicit instructions about what to do or not to do, and what to say or not to say, in order to support the parents' idea of child raising. The black child may also hear negative talk about the black father from the grandparents or on the mother's side, or from the mother's new man. Often arguments occur about the child's father between the mother and her new man. All kinds of derogatory remarks may be made by the new man if he is jealous of the biological father. Sometimes the mother herself will make the comments to try to convince her new man that she has no remaining feelings for the child's father. This is wrong, and it confuses the child. Some children defend the absent parent, while others will agree with the charges. Thus, the black man is not always unfeeling when he does not maintain a flourishing relationship with his child by an estranged mate. He continues to look for peace elsewhere. He may become single focused on trying to make a new home for himself someplace else. He is by nature driven to mate. The black man has added pain of the black mother refusing to allow him to discipline the child or have a say in his activities. She claims that she is the mother and the child will do as she says. The black father must insist on taking an active part, when possible, of raising the black child. Certainly, there are cases where when the father's presence is emotionally unhealthy for the child, so separation must prevail. However, this decision should not be made based on money, dollars, cents. The black woman is under the misplaced notion that if the black man does not contribute financially to the child, that he can have no say-so in the child's rearing, or make any decisions concerning the child. And in some cases, She even refuses to let him see the child. While it is certainly true that the black man should help to take care of the maternal needs of his children, mere money alone should not be the total measure as to whether or not he can be involved in his child's life. Black children are not for sale between the parents, and their emotional care should not be based on who spends the most or pays the most for the child. There are situations where this black man cannot provide for himself or anyone else. The black woman charges him for being in the condition he is in, and will refuse his participation in the child's upbringing based on financial child support. It has been proven that money alone is not sufficient to raise a well-adjusted child. Their emotional needs and mental stability must be met by both mother and father. Whomever is the best qualified and suited to contribute financially to the child should do so. Whether it be the mother, the father, or both, the child needs both parents, regardless of how the parents may feel about it. The children should not suffer because the parents do not get along as husband and wife or lovers. A black mother needs all of the sincere input she can muster up to help raise her sons and daughters. She is not qualified to do this alone. She has too many emotional problems herself. She and the children need a man daily to help support and steady them both. This kind of needed assistance from the black man has nothing to do with money. Needless to say, the black man's responsibility to his children is a real one, and it is a responsibility that should be accepted and respected. The U.S. judicial system and courts should have nothing to do with it. It is not their business or authority. In the rearing of black children, the black mother should screen all TV shows, cable, movies, and social activities before allowing the child to see or participate in them. The values and judgments formed by children from external sources play a major part in how the child will form opinions. The black mother must devise her own entertaining activities whenever possible. Home games, arts and crafts, field trips, family outings, story time, religious training, chores, biking, cooking, picnics, the beach, amusement parks, etc., are just a few social activities that children can participate in. Of course, they all require the accompaniment of an adult. There is no end to the list of interactive and entertaining socializations. But the black mother must join in herself and not leave it to the creativity of others to amuse and teach her child. And it is senseless to try to give a child each and everything they point at. Certainly, not just to amuse it, she will often treat the child or children as if they are an interruption in her life instead of the reason for it. Raising the nation is the first responsibility of the black woman after caring for her man. If blacks want better children, there must be better mothers who are genuinely interested in raising children and concerned about the outcome of her child rearing tactics. Another area of insensitivity The black woman practices is that she is too lax and careless with the child's safety when she has another man or other than the child's father spending the night with her. Black women become so engrossed in their social experiences with whomever her man is at the time, at the moment, that she does not place enough priority on privacy. Privacy to ensure that the child does not ever hear her having intimacies with her man. Single black women may have many men over the course of their children's lives during 18 years. Since the black woman is not sensible enough to make and settle down with a good choice, she is periodically speculating and becoming involved with new men. Her affairs have a definite pattern of beginning, middle, and end. She becomes familiar with the schedule and is able to predict the longevity of a relationship by the age of 30. She learns to function and enjoy each stage and will actually look forward to them. The opening and the closing. Her routine does not change. She believes that her program is right and that if she holds on to it, eventually she will find the right man. Her problem, as she sees it, is that she just keeps getting with the wrong men. Her hunt for the right man can encompass 20, 30, or 40 years. She does not realize that at the end of every failed relationship, that she is possibly guilty of the same behavior that destroyed the previous one. Her blindness makes her see things that are not really there. She is so desperate and headstrong, she persists in her same game plan, seeking one man after another to satisfy obnoxious demands. If she finally gets to the one she claims she really wants, but abuses him so much that he doesn't want her, she will institute several processes to prevent this from happening, at least to prolong the inevitable, and give her some secure leverage against the man. As a last resort, she will get pregnant. Every black woman knows that no matter what the future brings, if she has a baby by a man, she will be included in his life some kind of way for at least about 20 years. In this position, she feels her benefits of connection to the man outweigh the fact that the man doesn't want her, and that she tricked him into being forced to deal with her. She believes the baby gives her a right to contact him at any time, have mutually concerned discussions, forced him to deliver money to her, consult him in family emergencies concerning the child, which she sometimes make up, and will require him to have contact with her on a routine basis if she can arrange it. On one side, she dotes on the child to impress the father, and on the other hand, if the child does not provide her with any of the aforementioned amenities with the father, she may lose interest in it. This is a very dangerous rectangle for the child. It can come to represent its low down dog of a father, or be blamed for broken career dreams. In either case, the innocent baby suffers, since to the black woman, it can come to represent a failure. The failure of a relationship and the failure of a plan. One she is stuck with. Sometimes black women decide that they have finally birthed the golden child they have prayed for all their lives. Hallelujah! They trade wifedom for motherhood. The baby becomes the center of her life. She neglects the father, the house, and herself in order to worship the baby. This is not the way it should be. The baby is a physical manifested result of the union between the man and the woman. And therefore, the baby is third, not first. The black woman will treat the black man as if he had no part in creating the baby, and will direct her every waking moment to caring for the baby and ignoring the man. This is wrong. The black man should not be bumped out of his rightful place as the most important entity in the home just because he reproduced himself via his woman. This does not mean that the black baby should be devalued or mistreated, but the black man is first. His needs must be attended to in such a way as not to make him feel that he must come in second to his own offspring. A newborn baby is not God and should not be worshipped. It has its place and priority, but it does not have superiority over the man who made it. The black man must recognize this practice and correct it as soon as possible. The black woman should also not be allowed to bring the baby into the bedroom and keep it there for month after month. The black woman must be introduced to a new household organizational schedule after she births a child. If this is not done, she becomes confused and will consider the black man's presence an interruption between her and her new toy, the one that he implanted in her womb while making her feel good. If the black man has children by another woman from a previous relationship, the black woman does not like it and may not accept the child as the sister or brother of the one she has. She may do everything she can to keep her child from even knowing that other children exist who have the same father. She bases this on her warped ideas of what she believes her child's family structure should be like. She may insist that her child have expensive toys and clothes and gadgets galore. And if the black man pays child support to what is wrongly labeled as his outside child, she increases her demands to make sure that hers is well taken care of first. She discounts the desire of the black man to have all his seed know and love each other. He is often forced to live a double life because if he brings up his outside child at home, his live-in black woman will raise hell. Excuse me. Let me just emphasize. His live-in black woman will raise holy hell. She may selfishly think only of herself and will try to prevent any of her friends from knowing that her man has other children. She and her family may not include his outside child in family gatherings or holiday activities. If she must confront or accept the child, she may slyly ask questions to learn about the mother or to find out how much time her man actually spends with it. She refers to the child that she births as mine and to the other child as his.
This is wrong. They are all his. Black women are also famous for not trusting each other with each other's children if they have them by the same man. They think because of what is in their own hearts that the other woman may mistreat her child. All of this is ignorance because children are always elated to find out or meet their other sisters and brothers. Some black children are deprived of this right for many years, sometimes until adulthood. Whether or not the children should know each other should be discussed in terms of the development of the children, not the whim of the adults. Sometimes separation is the only way it can be, but the black man should have the final say-so on his children. And the black woman should do her part to form the kind of nation that he chooses for his offspring. Until the black woman accepts her appointed duty as mother and wife, blacks will continue to see the destruction of the black family. There is no magic about how a nation survives to leave a legacy of a glorious past. There are principles that govern the outcome of any given set of circumstances. By abandoning the principles of a civilized black society, the black woman has instead absorbed a set of mores that help destroy black people. She is waiting for something external to happen in order to change herself internally, to change the way she thinks, the way she thinks about her man and her children and any other children he sires. Few children are planned, but they are only a byproduct of sexual intercourse. It is impossible for a black woman to raise a black male child who is confident and secure if during his lifetime, all he hears from his mother is derogatory remarks about black men. He is usually attached to his mother, and she is often treats him as if he is deaf. She talks to her friends and family and does not realize the male child may be paying rapt attention to her every word and action. She does not have a special set of guidelines she uses to raise her boy child. The most she knows about the development of a black boy is to make sure that he develops physically, usually sports-wise, so he can gain the muscle strength and masculinity he will need as a man. She is used to changing with the times and therefore has no sense of steady direction by which to steer the black boy. Often she makes the boy child hang out with she and her women friends. She knows little about how to make a man, so the boy is overly exposed to the feminine side of life. The black woman has a very special love for her male baby. Her boy remains her prize. She may also change clothes in front of the boy, bathe, or walk around half dressed. She will also allow him to sleep in the same bed with her for an inordinate length of time, up to several years old. She says she doesn't see anything wrong with this type of behavior. After all, she says, "I'm his mother." When he is born, she lays him on her stomach or chest and lets him sleep there. It is a bonding process. After he is weaned, sometimes she continues to let him sleep on top of her or across her lap. While this is not a questionable practice of a mother, it is not always a good idea for a male baby because he becomes too accustomed to the scent of his mother's body, including her vagina. During this stage, she may also be kissing him in the mouth or sucking his lips instead of kissing him on the cheeks or forehead. She also thinks that this practice is okay. She's his mother. The baby is not mentally developed enough to understand that his mother is prohibited to him sexually. He may not even be able to understand or identify it as a sexual attraction, since the sensation of being close to his mother's body has always been pleasurable to him. It is also pleasurable to the mother, just as nursing is. The black mother is not intentionally participating in unhealthy behavior with the baby, with her baby son. She just doesn't know any better. The mother has a special relationship with her son. This is not to say that the daughter is estranged from her or that the baby girl is less adored, but the black baby slash boy represents the only black male that the black woman can execute any control over, and she may try to wean him off all ideas, notions, and attitudes she resents in the black adult male. In effect, she tries to brainwash him against the natural traits of his nature. She may preach to him from a very young age that she does not want him to turn out like his father. The confused values and ideas the black woman stores are not limited to the black girl. She cannot successfully raise a black male child without a black man. She does not have it in her. She barely knows how to teach or train the black female child, and she knows absolutely nothing about how to be a man to a woman or a woman to a man. Unfortunately, she will use her children as a way to get back at the black man or punish him. She will refuse to allow the black father to have access to the child based on the adult problems she and her and the father are having. The children should not suffer because of the disagreements between the parents. She would rather the child not have a father figure or be shifted from one man friend to the next, rather than allow the black father to raise his own child. Unless the black father voluntarily gives up his rights as a father for the peace and benefit of the child, the mother should promote the relationship. And no, it is not enough for the black woman to just say she wants the black man. She must also be in agreement with him about his goals, his lifestyle, his home life, and how he wants to raise his children. She must believe in him and have confidence that he can provide and protect her. She claims that she starts out believing and giving the man the benefit of the doubt, but that he always messes up. She does not understand that her benefit in giving him the benefit of the doubt is not good because there is no benefit in the doubt. If she doubts him, the doubt will grow until decay sets in. Black people in America have demonstrated that it is impossible for them to unite as a group and agree on a common goal. However, unity remains the most powerful tool on earth to change the condition of something or someone. The practice of unity must begin in the home of the black woman, and it is there where she must set the example for the new nation. The black woman is the vehicle of the diseased ideas that permeate the minds of black youth. She allowed destructive suggestions to invade her children and did not replace them with better values. She cannot properly teach her children until she has properly taught herself. Motherhood skills are not automatic. The mother love connection to the cub is automatic, but that feeling is just the basis for inspiration to do the other work necessary to raise the child. The black woman must have a new set of instructions and mothering techniques that will produce a new black child. It may take up to 50 years just to retrain the black woman to respect the black man. It is the black woman who must institute this change, and it is a change that must be made in the cradle, and one she must learn to practice. If the black woman chooses fancy clothes and jobs over saving her man, children, and home, the American government cannot be charged with inflicting genocide on black people. She says herself will be guilty of suicide and murder. She destroys herself and kills off her nation as a whole. Graveyards and incinerators are filled with the fruit of her womb, and she is not concerned. She believes that there is not enough room on earth for her child, and she believes she will not be able to afford to raise it. And she believes that birth control is the key to her well-being and future. She assents to abortion. She does not recognize her power. She practices selective breeding because she alone decides which black child will be born and which one will not. The statistics she read about black teenage pregnancy convince her that something must be done about the black birth rate. Something has been done, and if it were not for the natural drive of nature and young black unprepared mothers, the population numbers of the black nation in America would be moving towards nearing extinction. These young girls, as undesired as they may be, are birthing the black nation of tomorrow. Against practicality, everyone's wishes. But black babies are being born, and they need guidance of black fathers. Older black men must teach and train young black men about how to be proper fathers and guides. The black woman does not know that every black man that exists to carry on his seed. He wants to reproduce himself and continue his bloodline. Many black women defer having children until they accomplish educational goals, career status, travel, etc. Oftentimes, the last thing they want is the responsibility of a baby. So it becomes easier for the black man, who knows about this idea, to accept that he too does not want children. And of course, there are strident financial considerations, doctors, pediatricians, hospital bills, baby furniture, clothes, diaper, food, milk, medicine, and so forth. The black woman is the ultimate consumer and, whenever possible, will purchase the most expensive items as a way to show her love for the child. She chooses expensive shows of opulence to impress her friends and to make sure the black man financially does his part for the child. They can be a tremendous economic strain on the black man and his family. He knows that the strain will be great because he is aware of the black woman's unhealthy desire for material things. It is less trouble for him to agree that he doesn't want any children either. It is impossible for a black man not to want sons and daughters from his own loins. Every creature desires to reproduce itself. Consequently, the black woman must sacrifice her dashing, well-planned American future for the honor of reviving the black nation. She must get an order. The order that the black woman was in to produce all the other great and successful black nations. She cannot control the black man and be successful. She cannot yet comprehend that what she is battling in the black man is his very nature, which cannot be grafted out. It is his very nature to accept certain things and reject others, to do certain things no matter what the cost. The black man in America is the only male on earth, including every continent, who is disrespected by the woman in his nature. The situation does not exist anyplace else among the billions of people inhabiting our planet except here in America. The other black men, the yellow men, the red men, the brown men, and the white men are all honored and respected in their respective nations. All other women recognize and accept the man as the authority, the ruler, and the leader. Only here, only in the black nation, scattered throughout the United States, is the man neglected. This is not a natural situation. Women from other countries do not collectively band together to destroy their men. They are in accord with the natural order of the universe. Man first, then woman. This is not to say that the woman does not have rights of equality within her domain or any other domain that her man chooses to award her with. No matter how much education, money, dowry, national or local prestige other women have, they do not try to take over and rule their men. If the black woman, in all of her infinite wisdom, is so competent, then why are there two generations of black drug addicts, homosexuals, lesbians, paranoid schizophrenics, and murderers? Each of these pitfall black men and black women, or black youth, as the case may be, were born of a black woman. If the black woman would give as much attention to raising her children as she gives to her wardrobe, her hair and nails, we would not have the self-destructing youth seen today. It is the mother who must teach and train the child. It is a job, and it is a job not without accountability. The black woman's greatest dream is to have the black man be a father to her babies. She wants him to love them and spend time with them. And she wants him to insist on being a father to his child. She wants him to claim the seed he implanted in her womb. About child support. Today's laws for enforcing child support payments are very strenuous. The courts are arresting fathers who fall behind in their contributions. Many black men claim that they do not like to pay child support because their child's mother does not use the money to take care of the child, and instead uses the weekly or monthly payments from the father to purchase clothing or other frivolous articles that are in no way directed towards the upkeep of the child. This is not a difficult problem to rectify. When the black man is convinced that the child is not receiving the benefit of his financial contributions, it is better for him to take an active interest in and learn how to shop for his child or children so that he can make the purchases himself. This obviously requires the estranged black father to be actively involved in a parent-child relationship, during which time he is able to observe the child's clothing, medical, or toy needs. Shopping trips with a child are a favorite activity and create an outing during which lunch can be included, perhaps a movie or window shopping. The black mother will not like an arrangement where she does not get her hands on the money. But as long as the father is doing his part to help provide for the child, she will not be able to refuse assistance or reject this form of subsidy. No, under no circumstances should the child suffer because the black father believes that his child is not benefiting from his child support payments. The black mother will often exaggerate the cost of items as she claims the child needs, so that the father will have to come up with an unusual sums of money. As always already mentioned, the American judicial system has no business having to force a black father to take care of his own children. The main way he is willing to do this is if he has an active role in the child's growth and development. End of chapter 10.